talking with Emma Brocks. She has written She Left Me the Gun, My Mother's Life Before Me. It's published by Penguin Press. Welcome, Emma.
Thank you.
And what an interesting book, because you've made the first half how you related with your mother, what life was like with her, how she would get depressed, and she never really told you about why she left South Africa.
She didn't. I knew some basic facts about her life. I knew that she'd been the oldest of eight siblings. She had seven half-siblings. I knew that her father had been a gold miner and that they'd grown up in these slightly bleak-sounding compounds outside of Johannesburg. And I knew that she'd emigrated to England in 1960. But we never saw these people. They never rang. We never visited. They never visited. So there was kind of a blank where a background should be.
She had one friend, I believe it's Joan, who's in this picture, and she would call her on birthdays, or they would write to each other because it was an era where people wrote.
It was very touching, yes. They maintained a 40-year-long correspondence in a way that just doesn't happen anymore. They were lifelong best friends. They met when they were at work. They were both bookkeepers. They met in an office in Johannesburg in the 1950s. I showed no interest in any of this at the time. It was only after my mother's death that I started to be interested in all the things that she hadn't been telling me.
How old was she when she died?
She was 70.
Uh-huh. And you were already a writer?
I was a journalist, yes, with The Guardian in England, and I was 27.
And she had in her drawer all of the letters, and now it was your, what was Mother really like? And that included she had a gun.
That's right. I think when a parent dies, your relationship with their history changes overnight, and suddenly all the things that you have been desperately uninterested in, you become fascinated by, and you have a choice as to whether you're going to take on that history or let it follow your parent into oblivion. And once my mother had died, I started thinking about all the things that didn't quite add up, one of which was the fact that we had this gun in the house, which she told me she had smuggled over to England from South Africa, wrapped in a pair of knickers and stuffed at the bottom of her trunk in 1960. And she always said that the reason that she'd had it was that everyone in Johannesburg, when she was growing up, had a firearm. I had no reason to disbelieve her.
And your father was a lawyer. They had met while, I guess, she was working as an assistant or in the firm. But during your lifetime with her, she worked in a jewelry store. And that was interesting, too.
She did. She was a bookkeeper in a jewelry store several towns over. I used to love going with her during school vacations. I would sit and watch her use the adding machine. She accumulated a lot of very nice pieces. The point to make is that we had a very ordinary existence, my mum, my dad, and I, living in a very mild, green, leafy village in the south of England, which, as it turned out, was about as far removed from her own childhood as you could possibly get, which I discovered after her death.
And that picture was just of your mother and father on their wedding night, or wedding day, rather. Now we get to you go back to South Africa, and where to find the relatives, and how to find in the news, because journals are kept, that your grandfather had gone to jail. He had killed a man. He got married to your grandmother. Your mother was born and a brother, and then she became ill, and he also had been, he was a child molester.
He was a psychopath, basically. He was a convicted murderer and a child molester. And after my mother's mother died, when my mom was 2 years old, she was left in the sole care of this man.
Yeah.
He was not a fit parent, as you can imagine.
And not only that, but later he has molested the other children, and your mother gets the gun, and she didn't have very good aim, is all I can say.
She really wasn't very good at it. She should have gone to a firing range, maybe, and practiced, but she did after years of trying to get the authorities to show an interest in what was going on in the house. And you must remember this was 1950 South Africa, where it was very hard to get any kind of domestic abuse case taken seriously. She finally took the law into her own hands, and she had a gun, and she fired it, but she wasn't very effective. So even though she fired five or six times, she managed not to eliminate her father.
What is interesting is that at that stage, she files a lawsuit against her father. And in the first part, she wins. A year later, she loses.
That's right. She, through sheer force of will, she perseveres and goes back to the authorities once again. And this time she manages to get him arrested. And the case goes before the South African equivalent of the grand jury, and he is found guilty and is referred to the High Court in Johannesburg. And at that stage, his second wife, my mother's stepmother, from what one can tell, loses her nerve and lies to protect her husband. And he is found ultimately not guilty. And that's the point at which my mother left the country.
But what's amazing is he represents himself.
Extraordinary.
And what you have put in this book of what went on from the trial, you're thinking, he is so shrewd, and how did he get away with it?
He was very clever. It is extraordinary what the law permitted at the time, which was that a man on trial for molesting his own children was permitted to defend himself and cross-examine those children in open court in the witness box, and as he did in this case, destroy them one by one. Mm-hmm. It's almost unimaginable, the idea of a 6-year-old or a 12-year-old having to somehow stand up to her abuser in open court, in front of the press, in front of the judge, in front of a jury. So it's little surprise that he managed to get free.
Then what happened to him?
Well, there was a slight poetic justice in that my mother emigrated in 1960. She took the boat, as people did then, from Cape Town to Southampton, a 2-week voyage. When the ship docked in Southampton, a steward came and found her and said that there was a telegram waiting for her at the Union Star office. She went in, picked it up, and it was from her stepmother telling her that while she was at sea, her father had dropped dead in the street of a brain hemorrhage.
Yeah. So there was ironic justice. Now we come, you go back to visit, to talk to each of her siblings. And it was interesting, you had to fly places. They were one living on the ocean, one is sort of like a derelict.
Right.
Describe what you found with the sisters and with the brothers.
Well, I had no idea whether they would even want to meet me. My mum hadn't seen any of her siblings for almost 40 years. I knew that they'd kept in slight contact, but I didn't know whether they'd be interested in meeting me. And I knew that they would probably be, from the small things that she'd said, I knew that they would be strenuously eccentric. So, yes, there was my mum's brother, Tony, who was living in a garage in eastern Johannesburg, surrounded by engine parts with a mattress in the corner. There was another of my mum's brothers who was living out in the wilderness in a shack. There were her sisters, some of whom had talked about what happened to them, others who hadn't. So sort of every kind of reaction to childhood trauma was represented in those seven siblings.
And even among the sisters, there was competition.
Extraordinary, yes. Yeah. I mean, I think in a family of that size, birth order becomes sort of very important, and you're trying to fight to find ways to stand out. So there were normal competitiveness existed within the siblings. So, you know, as well as having survived this incredible trauma, they also bickered about which of them had middle child syndrome and had the right to be more upset about that than the other.
Now you go back to London and you decide to go back again as a journalist.
That's right. It felt like a necessary psychological sort of safety net. I'd been a journalist at that point for 10 years almost. And I thought the only way to absorb this kind of material without being too destabilized by it was to do it as if it was just another story, and as if these people weren't my relatives but were, you know, the regular people that I interviewed during the course of my daily job.
Your mother, when she died, had left a note. I do not want anyone at my funeral, just you and your father.
Mm. She didn't like weeping and wailing. She was not one for complaining. She would always shout at you if she thought you were being sorry for yourself. And I just knew exactly what she would have been thinking, which is that if she was the only dead person in a room full of people, it would put her at an insurmountable disadvantage. So it was only my dad and I who were allowed to be there.
Yeah, but you did have another sort of memorial for her.
We did. We honoured her wishes in terms of the funeral, but then I think 6 months later, my dad and I cracked and decided that we wanted to do something to celebrate her life. So we invited some of my friends, some of my mum's old friends from the 60s, from London, and we had a very joyous lunch in the village.
It's interesting. Her friends from the 60s, were many of them were in an era of slightly gay.
Right. So she, yeah. When she came to England, she had 10 years before she met and married my dad, during which time she effectively rebuilt herself. And she was helped in that process by a group of terrific friends. In fact, the best friends that a woman coming out of that kind of background could hope for, which is a group of gay men who loved and nurtured her.
And you were like her life. Yeah.
She was a very devoted mum.
Yeah.
She was.
And everything came to you from her because she had no other children.
She didn't. It was just me. And I think because she had had such a desperately awful childhood, she was absolutely emphatic that I would have nothing ugly in my life, to the extent that, you know, no one was allowed to even swear around me. A pristine environment was to be maintained around her only child at all time. But I have to say, at the same time, she was quite a hard taskmaster. She didn't spoil me. She was quite impatient, but she was a very good mum.
Did you live away during college?
I did, yes. Not very far away, only an hour away.
Yeah. So you were able to cut the umbilical cord a little.
Yeah, which is all credit to my mother, because she got incredibly nervous when I left the house. I mean, even if I was going to the shops five minutes away, she would go through this comic routine with me, which was a way for her to normalize her neuroses. Because, of course, if you come from her kind of background, inevitably you have some psychological fallout.
How much did your father know?
My dad knew about as much as I did, which was that he knew her father had been a paedophile, he knew that he'd been a violent alcoholic, and he knew there'd been a court case. But beyond that, he knew very little. My mum had, the way I liken it in the book is to a First World War soldier who came back from the trenches and didn't want to share the horrors that he'd seen with his family. Well, my mum was like that, and my dad respected her decision not to talk about it.
Yeah. Was it difficult writing the book?
It was incredibly difficult writing the book. It took a long time. You have to be very careful, I think, with this kind of material that you're not exploiting it for sensationalism. I wanted to honour my mum's tone of voice, which was joyful. I mean, there are some grim things in this book, but I hope it's a joyful book.
It is. It definitely is. Emma, it's a beautiful book, and it's too bad she's not here to read it.
Thank you.
Will you autograph my book? And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. Look for our show. You can also read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. And support your local library, because whatever you do, libraries are our finest democratic institution. What did a library mean to you growing up?
Oh, I loved the local library. I used to, when I was a kid, you could take 6 books out a week, and I would race through them and renew them every Monday. It meant the world to me.
And whatever you do, support it, and thank the librarian, because they are the people who keep the literary lights burning. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much,
Emma.
Thank
you, Connie. Thank you.